According to reports from the Red Army General Staff, today at 1545, our troops stationed on the Karelian Isthmus at the border with Finland near the village of Mainila were suddenly fired upon from Finnish territory by artillery. Three Red Army soldiers and a junior commander were killed, and 8 Red Army soldiers were wounded. Therefore, the Soviet government, with a strong protest, proposes the government of Finland immediately withdraw its troops to 20 to 25 kilometers from the Karelian Isthmus. The Soviet government sent this note of protest November 26, 1939. In fact, it was not the Finns who attacked the Soviet military base. Soviet secret services arranged the shelling of their own territory. Moscow created a pretext to invade Finland.
Soviet historiography, of course, saw that it was the Finns who attacked against the Soviet Union. That was the casus belli for the war. But as we know from the 1990s, the Soviet historiography was changing, and there was really a basis and archival material which was making a proof, which was showing that it was the Beria, the secret police of the Soviet Union, which really instigated the whole situation. It was a kind of a show thing.
We do know that the Russians themselves took shots into this village of Mainila on the Russian side of the border. But up to now we don't know who actually on the Soviet side were involved. But of course we know that it was government, and there is an actually very good plan for this Mainila incident in Andrei Zhdanov's archives. Andrei Zhdanov was the party secretary in Leningrad at the time.
The Finns proposed to the Soviet Union to conduct a joint investigation, but the Kremlin does not even consider the proposal. November 29th, Finland's ambassador to the Soviet Union, Irja Koskinen, is called to the People's Commissariat of Foreign Affairs, and there handed a note. The note says that because of the provocative actions of Finland, the Soviet Union was no longer able to have normal relations with Helsinki, and broke all diplomatic ties. This meant the beginning of the war. In history, there are many examples when small populations become a symbol of courage and endurance. In such cases, the preservation of the nation does not depend on the number of soldiers, but the strength of spirit and selfless love of country. In the 20th century, Finland was an example of such courage. A country with a population of 5 million people was able to stop the huge Red Army, almost exclusively due to patriotism and endurance. Despite the fact that Russia stole a large portion of Finnish territory, the people of Finland preserved what was most vital, their independence. Finland was not put on its knees. How could a small country perform this miracle? And what happened here in the winter of 1939 to 1940? The Winter War. Finland joined the Russian Empire in 1809. And although Finland regained its independence after the Bolshevik Revolution in 1917, Moscow continued to regard it as a zone of influence. In 1918, local communists launched an armed uprising with the support of the Kremlin and occupied a significant part of the country, including Helsinki. The Red Terror began in the territory under their control. Within a few months, the communists shot about 3,000 people. The Finns responded to the Red Terror with similar methods. The civil war had dire consequences. The 1918-1919 fratricidal confrontation claimed the lives of nearly 20,000 people. Despite numerous attempts, the communists were unable to return Finland to the new Russian Empire. Under the leadership of Marshal Carl Gustav Mannerheim, Finnish patriots supported by a German expeditionary force were able to win the independence of the state and defeat the Red Army. In 1920, in Tartu, Finland and Russia signed a peace agreement. Moscow recognized the independence of its former vassal. Despite the peace agreement, the two countries were not able to establish good neighborly relations. Russia tried to destabilize the situation in Finland through the International Organization of Communists and actively supported the underground Communist Party. Because of this, Helsinki acted carefully with its neighbor and didn't trust the Red to the end. During this period, Finnish foreign policy was defined by one postulate: any enemy of Russia is a friend of Finland. In 1932, Finland and the Soviet Union signed a non-aggression treaty. But even this did not ease tensions in the relationship between the two countries. It was obvious that the Soviet Union considered the independence of Finland as a temporary phenomenon. Russia was just waiting for the right time for an attack. The Finnish government, which faced a clear external threat, began strengthening its army. Beginning in 1935, 25% of the state budget was spent on buying new weapons.
Finnish army was not well equipped before the Winter War broke out in late 1930s. It was mainly we were lacking artillery, ammunition to the artillery. We didn't have that many tanks either. The only biggest power was the common understanding of all the Finns that we have to defend our country by all means. So it was mostly based on infantry and rifles and mines. We were not well equipped, but well trained.
There were more recruits than weapons. And the rifles and machine guns and so on, they were the old Russian model from the First World War. But also the Russians had, most of them had these kinds, but then the Finns had no modern tanks, only some which were not, didn't have guns.
On the initiative of Marshal Mannerheim, a 135-kilometer line of defense along the border with the Soviet Union is created. Trenches, machine gun bunkers, pillboxes, and artillery systems are connected to each other. Everyone worked to build the line. At that time, many took part in the construction of the Mannerheim line. Every day, people come here from nearby villages and districts and voluntarily performed different jobs. It was an impressive sight. Finnish people worked tirelessly. I remember the photos published in the press. In one of them, a university professor was holding a metal wedge, and another Finn, a worker by profession, was beating it with a hammer to split stones. These photos clearly reflect the unity and hardness of the Finnish people. In 1938, the Soviet Union begins a series of negotiations with Finland in order to increase the influence of the Russian military in the state. The Bolsheviks offer cooperation for common defense against foreign enemies. The Kremlin needs to lease several islands in the Gulf for 30 years. The Soviet Union intended to place military bases on these islands. For neutral Finland, these proposals are unacceptable. Helsinki refuses the cooperation agreement. The non-aggression agreement, signed between Moscow and Berlin August 23, 1939, was the beginning of the war between Finland and the Soviet Union. In a secret part of the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, the Nazis and Communists split Europe. According to this redistribution, Finland, together with the Baltic countries, were in the interests of the Soviet Union. In the autumn, the Soviet Union begins the creeping occupation of Latvia, Lithuania, and Estonia. Under pressure from the Kremlin, the Baltic states sign an agreement under which the Soviet Union based its military there, beginning in October 1939.
As we know what the Baltic states did, they said yes. And that was a kind of, horrendous example. Ужасный экземпляр. If you're not fighting, you're losing everything. So, in a Finnish situation, it was at that time it was understood that we did the right thing, and especially in 1940 when all these three states were Sovietized, and what was the result? The elite of these three states was destroyed.
Next was Finland's turn. October 5th. The Kremlin proposes to continue the interrupted negotiations. In Moscow, a Finnish delegation arrives, led by State Councillor Juho Paasikivi. The negotiation process lasts a month. In connection with the outbreak of the Second World War, the Soviet Union offers Finland common defense. But Helsinki refuses the offer again. Then, the Kremlin puts forward another proposal. The Soviet Union, in order to ensure the security of Leningrad, demands the Finnish side move the border near the Karelian Isthmus. In this case, Finland would totally lose control over the Mannerheim Line, Lake Ladoga, and the Viipuri region. In addition, the Soviet Union demands to lease the Hanko Peninsula and islands located in the Gulf for 30 years. The Soviet Union intended to build bases there. As compensation to Helsinki, Moscow offers a 250-kilometer line in Karelia, which has no strategic value.
Karelian Isthmus. Soviet Union would like to have a big part of this isthmus. And this new borderline would have cut the Finnish main defense line. And because the Finns had no trust in Soviet Union, or there was, from both sides, there was no trust. So this was one of the points which were not going to be an agreement of. And Hanko, this base, it was something which was that was the reason why they didn't agree in 39, because the Finns would not like to have something behind their back.
The Finnish side did not agree to the losing exchange of territories. Helsinki categorically refused to lease the Hanko Peninsula and the islands in the Gulf, as this would open the door to a quick occupation of Finland. November 13th. The delegation led by Paasikivi halts negotiations and returns to Helsinki.
We should not give any inch to our land to anyone. That we are not threatening anyone, but we should not, you know, to make this petty horse trading with Stalin. I think there was the problem was that general feeling that we are having a right course. Why should we sell our territory? Because we are not really threatening anyone. We should not make these petty horse trading. And these negotiators, Mr. Paasikivi and Tanner, they had 110% full backup from Finland. And the people in Finland realized that now we are facing a very tough situation, a kind of a endangering situation. So there was a general feeling that our cause is right and we shouldn't do this.
In September, before the negotiations had started, the Soviet Union began concentrating military units near the border with Finland. November 3rd, when Moscow realizes that the Finnish side is not going to make any concessions, the Leningrad Military District and the Baltic Navy are brought to full combat readiness.
There was a kind of a feeling that, you know, as in a poker game, that it was a bluff. You know, they wanted to see that is the Soviet Union really bluffing. And the people really didn't believe that there would be a war. That, you know, the idea was that we haven't been causing any trouble to the Soviet Union. Why should they just invade Finland?
By mid-November, the issue of the war with Finland was finally settled, and the date was determined. November 30th. Despite the preparations, Bolshevik propaganda claimed the opposite. The Soviet government assured everyone that it respects the sovereignty of Finland. This statement was made by Foreign Affairs Commissar Vyacheslav Molotov the day before the start of the war, November 29th, 1939. Others argue that we have undertaken measures directed against the independence of Finland, or to interfere in its internal and external affairs. This is the same malicious slander. We believe Finland, however no such regime existed, is an independent and sovereign state in all its domestic and foreign policy. Our position is strong that their internal and external affairs should be decided by the Finnish people as they see fit. A few hours after this statement, the Soviet Union invaded Finland. November 30th, 1939, at 9 a.m. in the morning, there were Soviet bombers 15 minutes from Helsinki. The squadron consisted of 8 aircraft. They dropped 6 high-explosive bombs on the port. Several of them fell near the parliament and the zoo. Then the bombers dropped their bombs on densely populated residential areas. Most of the affected areas were between the Technical University and the bus station. In a few minutes, about 100 bombs exploded here. 91 civilians were killed. 240 people were injured. It is said that the city was burning. A large fire that was visible from the other side, in Tallinn. They bombed not only Helsinki. All major cities were bombed. Soviet aircraft dropped bombs on Kotka, Oulu, Viipuri. Parallel to the aircraft, the territory of Finland was fired on from warships. A Soviet naval landing on the first day seized a strategic island in the Baltic Sea. On the first day of the war, my father and I went to bring the cows some hay. When we were returning home, we heard a terrible noise on the north side. The railway station was there. When we got home, I learned that the war had begun. They bombed Viipuri, Enso, and their surroundings. At the railway station Kaliola, which was 10 miles away, the enemy dropped a bomb. That was the sound we heard when we returned home. I remember my father opened the window and shouted, "The war has begun!" Very soon we learned that several towns were bombed. I immediately went to the town of Kirkmuola, which was the headquarters of our group. This is how the war began. Shortly after the outbreak of the war, we were setting fires to our houses and apartments so that the enemy would have no place to live in the winter. There was so much smoke that a black cloud obscured the sky and the sun's rays could not make their way through it. The Bolshevik attack and the bombing of peaceful cities united Finnish society. Any ideological divisions disappeared. Leftist forces issued a joint statement saying that the working class of Finland would be in arms to defend their land against invaders. To combat the Soviet Union, in the Finnish army, even former Red Guards who supported the Bolsheviks were enlisted. They were the ones who wanted to establish a communist government in Finland in 1918.
There's no possibilities for discussion, and the way of the war is the only way to talk with Soviet Union at that time, because it was really against the civilian population. If you're looking for the strategic goals in Helsinki, of course, if you could say the government building, but these bombs were not really hitting there. They were really killing those innocent children and old people who were not able to go to the shelters. So it has really an opposite effect. It strengthened the so-called the elan of Finland to fight against the aggression.
After the outbreak of the war, the Soviet propaganda machine was at full power. Red Army soldiers were told that Finland had treacherously attacked the Soviet Union, and the Bolsheviks had to release the Finnish working class from the oppression of imperialism. Soviet newspapers reported that the Red Army was the most peace-loving army in the world, and was resisted by white Finnish mercenaries bought by the government. Over Helsinki, the Soviet Air Force dropped not only bombs, but also a proclamation. They said that the Finns would not starve because the Soviet Union had a lot of bread. Referring to the bombing of Finnish cities, Molotov generally argued that the planes dropped not bombs, but baskets, which were full of bread for starving Finns. December 1st, 1939. Pravda publishes reports that in the Finnish town of Terijoki, locals had rebelled against the bourgeois government and established a people's government. It was headed by Finnish communist Otto Kuusinen.
Otto Ville Kuusinen was one of the functionaries in Comintern and one of the leaders of the in Karelia, that means Russian Karelia, where there were quite a lot of Finns living. Popular Front idea, and then taking over the state police in Finland, and then imprisoning the Finns of nation, that's the same name as in Russia. So that was the same tactics which was then used in summer 1940 in the Baltic states. But the first version is in Finnish.
Kuusinen was really a tragical, pitiful figure at that time. First of all, if you're looking for the Communist Party, the Stalin had destroyed the best echelons, the best members of the Communist Party in 1930s. And which was left there were these pitiful persons like Kuusinen, who didn't really instigate any feeling inside Finland. He was passé. He was, you know, a forgotten figure.
The Kuusinen government was created by Moscow a few weeks before the start of the war. It was filled with Finnish communists who lived in the Soviet Union. In a short period of time, the Army of the People's Government was formed, which fought side by side with the Red Army against the capitalist regime. Already on the 2nd of December, Moscow signed an agreement with the Kuusinen government, which confirmed all territorial and military claims of the Soviet Union. While addressing the Finnish people, Kuusinen said that the Red Army was an army of liberation, and hundreds of thousands of Finnish workers and peasants were happily awaiting it in Finland.
Finnish people, everybody, understood that this is only a propaganda, that the Soviet Union is not really trying to make a peace with Finland, but trying to get its own puppet government to rule Finland. So these leaflets from the Kuusinen government were usually as a toilet papers, you know. And there was no effect to Finland. I mean, the opposite effect, of course, was there, that, well, voila, вот так. This is the, what is the fate of Finland? And secondly, of course,
when the these Russian conditions came to be known in public at the end of October, so everybody was, how can a country to come and ask us our land, and for no reason, and then when the war began, so the Soviet side formed this Kuusinen government.
The war internationally isolated the Soviet Union. On December 14, 1939, the Soviet Union was expelled from the League of Nations. The League of Nations did not agree with representatives of the Soviet Union that said the Kremlin would only assist the People's Government of Finland in the fight against the bandit regime with international aid. Despite this, Soviet propaganda continued to spread misinformation. All the fair sons and daughters of England, France, and America condemned the vile gang. From the Pope to London shopkeepers, who all shouted about the noble help that the Red Army is giving the Finnish people, who are fighting against their oppressors. The Finnish campaign, according to the Stalin plan, was to resemble the German Blitzkrieg in Poland. The Kremlin gave the military there 3 weeks to Sovietize Finland. The Red Army was to take Helsinki by December 21st, Stalin's birthday. To win, the Bolsheviks assembled a huge army. The Soviet Union mobilized four armies against the enemy, about 500,000 soldiers. The operation was supported by warships from the Baltic Fleet, more than 2,000 tanks, 2,500 aircraft, and up to 3,000 guns. 260,000 Finns fought back. Their armor consisted of 30 tanks and 270 combat aircraft. The main thrust of the Soviet army was into the Karelian Isthmus. The main task was to break through the Finnish defensive line and clear the way to Helsinki. The 7th Army led the offensive in this sector. A little further north, from Lake Ladoga, the 8th Army was to strike the main blow. From Karelia came the 9th Army. In addition, in the north, the Finns fought against the 14th Army, which was to cover the opponent's output to the Barents Sea. The most severe and bloody battles were fought in the Karelian Isthmus. After numerous losses, the Soviet 7th Army, only on December 13th, was able to reach the Mannerheim defensive line. Fighting on the ice at the Viipuri Bay was the most severe and unforgiving. It was a very difficult period. We had to guard the border day and night. There were severe frosts, and we had a very difficult time. Although we found an opportunity to protect our territory, they even managed to go on from the west side to the other side. Friends told me that on the ice, small scattered groups of Finnish soldiers were easily visible, and there were too many Russians. They stayed together through strong frosts. For 3 weeks, the Soviet troops fiercely attacked the Finnish position, but they could not break through. Commissars forced the soldiers into the open field under machine gun fire. In front of the Finnish trenches were mountains of dead Reds.
Sitten
When troops needed help from young people living in Karelia and Vipuri on the Mannerheim line, additional battalions were created. We were 16, 17, 18. I was 17 years old. Our mission was to help an experienced soldier. We were outside for days. We had nowhere to hide in negative 35 temperatures. Many had frostbitten toes. Then came the enemy tank attack. They went at us, shouting, "Hurrah!" And our battalion was ready to fight them. We helped the border guards. We were ordered to wear helmets. Our experienced military repelled the attack and set fire to Russian tanks with homemade grenades and Molotov cocktails. The Russians retreated. During the December fighting, the 7th and 8th armies lost almost 40% of their personnel. Killed, wounded, and frostbitten. Despite these sacrifices, the main Bolshevik attack was able to move ahead only 25 to 40 kilometers. Stalin's birthday plan failed. However, the Bolsheviks suffered the biggest catastrophe on the Karelian front in Suomussalmi.
Suomussalmi, Finetis, Chdilu Armasauletita.
Suomussalmi is located in northeastern Finland. In the summer, it has beautiful landscapes, but in winter, the temperature drops to minus 30 and freezes all around. In the winter of 1939 to 1940, the Soviet Army and Finnish troops fought a grand battle. If successful, the Soviet Union would have been able to cut Finland in half and get behind the Mannerheim line. The main objective was the Finnish port of Oulu, which at the same time was a major railway junction. The Finnish army was receiving most of its weapons and necessary resources for war from this port. December 16th, the Second Army launches an attack in the direction of Oulu. After 2 hours of artillery bombardments, infantry divisions supported by armored vehicles cross the border and invade deep into Finnish territory. The Red Army movement was prevented by snow. The only road leading to Oulu was mined. But despite this, the tanks and infantry moved forward, albeit doggedly. The Finnish 9th Army responded with guerrilla warfare tactics. Finnish soldiers divided into small groups and suddenly attacked the long Soviet military column.
Finnish soldiers with white clothes and skis could ski quietly around the Red Army and attack because they saw those fires very long distance because it was dark all the time. So there were few Finnish soldiers, but they knew this area, they knew how to act, how to use uniforms, how to warm up and how to eat here. But all of this was very difficult and odd for the Red Army. They wasn't used to forest or darkness, snow, and for the cold, because it was colder than normally, 30, 40 degrees, so those weapons and lorries won't work. It was very difficult to survive. And so they frozen their legs and hands so that they had to cut it out from those foot and hands because they have frozen those legs and hands.
As a result, the 9th Army was surrounded. In order to break through the terrain on the Karelian front, the 44th Division was sent to assist the 9th Army, but it had the same results. The Suomussalmi operation ended disastrously for the Kremlin.
Finnelebma Rusetis Metzkhri Armis Divizia 8 kilometrian monakvechi gamoketes.
The Finns trapped the 9th Army in an 8-kilometer area and completely destroyed it within a month. The Soviet Union lost more than 20,000 soldiers. Those who were not killed by bullets were killed by the frost. When told of the death of more than 20,000 people, it is just statistics for many. It is difficult to perceive. To make people aware and comprehend this figure, a special field was made about Suomussalmi. In this field are 20,000 stones. Each stone equals a human life. In January 1940, the Soviet Union begins serious preparations to break the Mannerheim Line. Nearly all of the Red Army's aircraft and artillery stood at the border with Finland. On the main line, the 13th Army was sent to the aid of the 7th. The 8th Army received reinforcements. In the end, about 1 million soldiers were waiting for the order to attack the Karelian Isthmus. After the December experience, special teams of skiers were created. The army introduced the famous 100 grams, which were handed out to soldiers before the attack. February 1st, the Red Army launches a massive military barrage on the Mannerheim Line. More than 2,000 guns begin firing simultaneously on the enemy trenches. Finnish positions are bombed from the air. We were young, almost children, and we had no military education. We tried to help each other. Of course, we were afraid, but it is hard not to be frightened when next to you shells are exploding. But we believed that our cause was right. It gave us strength and courage. The continuous barrage lasted 10 days. In one day, Soviet artillery fired 12,000 shells at the Finnish defensive line. February 11th. As the big guns go silent, the Red Army goes on the offensive, and again, is unsuccessful. The Mannerheim Line repels all of the Bolshevik attacks. For the first time in the Finnish campaign, the Soviet Union begins to use heavy armor to support the infantry. During the Winter War, the Finnish Army had mostly British Vickers tanks in service. They were made at a factory in Newcastle. By November 1939, Finland had one tank battalion with 28 tanks like these. They faced a few thousand T-26 tanks from the Soviet Union. Despite this disadvantage, Finland lost only 8 tanks during the Winter War, while the Red Army lost 2,300. Against T-26 tanks, the Finns used Molotov cocktails. It was a mixture of gasoline and fuel oil, poured in usual bottles with a wick. Incidentally, this is a real Molotov cocktail. The Finns threw it into the ventilation hatch of a T-26, and the tank went down.
And you had to be brave enough to go in the vicinity of the tank and try to throw it onto the superstructure of the tank, especially to the engine compartment cover was the target. And it was thrown very close from the tank. Well, of course, it depends on the situation, but from 5 meters to max 10 meters. And when the glass bottle broke down, and there was a kind of matches which were taped on that bottle, and it set off the whole tank, and especially the engine compartment. When it was burning, the tank was for sure destroyed.
After a week of continuous fighting, the Red Army is finally able to break through the Finnish lines February 17th. There, Finns risk being encircled. Because of this, Marshal Mannerheim gave the order to retreat. But the Bolsheviks did not give the enemy an opportunity to gain a foothold in new positions. The Red Army broke through the second line of defense, pushing the Finnish army back to the city of Viipuri. The road to Helsinki was opened.
Silloin minä olin vielä 17-vuotias. Mutta yhtenä aamuna
I was only 17 years old. At the island where we were attacked by a group of 20 people, the Red Army. There were six of us, and we had to keep the defense. Three Russians were killed in this battle. The next day was my birthday. I turned 18. Communist gas masks and satchels became my birthday gifts. The Soviet Union still could not Sovietize Finland. Moscow saw that the Finnish people would not accept the occupation and would fight to the end. In addition, the Kremlin was forced to reckon with the opinion of the democratic community, which from the first day of the war supported the Finnish people. At the end of February 1940, the UK let Moscow know that it was concerned with the situation in Finland. London expressed the hope that the Soviet Union would not allow a further escalation of events, because it would force a third party to intervene. Britain threatened the Kremlin with war. In this case, the Soviet Union would have been inevitably in the same camp with Nazi Germany.
Stalin knew that there was this Western aid, the Western expedition was coming. He was quite sure that they were not able to help really the Finns. But that was not the fact, because he was afraid that he really had to go wage a war against Great Britain, France, and then, of course, the United States. The big mystery. What will the United States do? And that war he didn't want to wage. So for his side, he was able to, how to say, the preserve of the glory and prestige of the Red Army, and then make a peace with Finland.
On March 7th in Moscow, the Soviet Union and Finland began negotiations. The Kremlin was willing to cease hostilities if Helsinki agreed to its terms. On March 12th, the parties signed a peace treaty, under which the Soviet Union receives the Karelian Isthmus and the city of Viipuri. Several islands in the Gulf of Finland and the Barents Sea, including Petsamo, Ribači, and Medium, were put under Soviet jurisdiction. Lake Ladoga was completely left to the Soviet Union. In addition, the Kremlin leased the Hanko Peninsula for military bases for 30 years. In the end, Finland lost one-tenth of its territory.
Ჩვენ ახლა პუნქტ ვაალიმაში ვიმყოფებით. 1940 წლის მარტის სამშვიდობო ხელშეკრულებით.
We are now at the Valima Point. Under the peace treaty of March 1940, this is the new Finnish-Soviet border. Russia is 30 meters away. Russian border guards have checked vehicles traveling from Finland for the last 70 years. Behind them, instead of Finnish Viipuri, is Russian Viborg. 70 years ago, on that road deep into Finland, was an endless stream of refugees. 500,000 refugees left the occupied territory. They burned their own houses, destroying all important buildings that might be of interest. The Finns left nothing to the enemy. I went to the station and saw that all around, all the buildings were covered in fire. I went into the house. It was the last time I looked at my room, bed, furniture, and I said, and now it's time to leave. Everything around was burning. I was comforted by the only thought, the Russians will never enter our home. I have often repeated this thought, let it burn. The houses of many of my relatives had already been burned. I remember we had tears. I went out into the yard, rode on a horse, to the meaningful places for me. Then, with the train station, we sent the rest of the machines to Finland. Very soon, we all had to leave this place. I rode near the orchard and saw the rest of the flagpole. I took it down and sawed it into three pieces, so that nobody could hoist another flag on it. It was the protest of an 18-year-old boy who lost the land on which he was born, that was tended by 10 generations of his ancestors. The Soviet Union lost about 380,000 soldiers in the Winter War. The 7th, 8th, and 9th armies were almost completely destroyed. The losses among Finns amounted to 24,000. Tragic was the fate of thousands of Red Army soldiers who fell into Finnish captivity. After the end of the war, when there was an exchange of prisoners, they loaded them into cargo cars and sent them to Siberian prison camps as enemies of the people. The Kremlin was able to win this war only because of its vast amount of human resources. Unlike Finland, where every soldier that fell for his country was buried with special honors, the communists were free from such sentiments. The Bolsheviks did not count their soldiers. In the Soviet system, life was worth nothing. They say that after the war, when Stalin was informed of the losses, he was satisfied. Compared to the millions of victims during collectivization, the statistics of the Winter War looked better to the leader. First of all, we should admit, and I have said this before, that the fall of the Soviet Union was the greatest geopolitical catastrophe of the century.